Nibbling on sponge cake, watching the sun bake.
Ex-Superintendent Derek Fuchs, late of the Devon and Cornwall Police Force, is on a mission to find a man he hasn't seen for over 20 years.
Strumming my six string on my front porch swing.
The man he's looking for lives somewhere here in California, and he could have changed out of all recognition. He's heir to an estate in Cornwall with a community ready and willing to call him their squire. But for some reason, he refuses to take possession of it.
Searching for my lost sugar salt.
It's a strange story and one that is being written into Cornish folklore. Derek Fuchs wants to find out why someone would turn their back on 1,000 acres of prime English farmland. And he's got just a week to find his man. The story really starts here at the Hoblyn estate in deepest, darkest Cornwall. Tenants would come here to pay their rent and respect to Squire Hoblyn. At the very centre was Fir Hill Manor, once the pride of the county. And now, because no one from the family would care for it, a piece of English history crumbling into obscurity. This is a true Cornish mystery. 60 years ago, the estate was run by two sisters, Frances and Wilhelmina Hoblyn. They both died childless, and the estate finally came to rest in the hands of a distant American relative, the current squire, John Paget Figg Hoblyn, the man who doesn't want to know. A farmer who remembers him well is Lewis Trebilcock.
I would like the squire, as we always called the Hoblyns, to come back. We've got a lovely little parish here at Colan. It's a very friendly parish with a lovely old church in it and a Methodist chapel, and he's the biggest landowner in the parish. And I think it would be lovely to have, you know, someone here, you know, Squire John, as we would call him then, or Squire John Paget, would be a... It would certainly add to, you know, what we've already got.
Twenty years ago, John Paget Figg Hoblyn came to the estate, but even then he was hesitant about becoming the squire. He stayed with one of his tenants, Jack and Heir.
I said, why don't you have this? What is wrong? How is it that you don't seem to be able to get this estate? And he said to me, if I can't have it my way, I don't want it. I thought it was just a matter of coming over here, claiming it, and settling in.
Would you say that was a good likeness?
Oh, yes, that's him. Yes, without a doubt. That is John Hoblyn, without a doubt.
During a long stay in Cornwall, he collected rents from some of the tenants, but he didn't make many friends here. He treated people with the utmost suspicion, and after a while, he left for America without accepting legal title. Over 100 years ago, the Hoblyns were one of the leading families in the county. Squire Hoblyn had 4 daughters. There was Frances and Zoe, and Rosalind, who was to become the key figure in the mystery, and Wilhelmina, and a chronic alcoholic brother called Ernest. Their mother, Jane, was the strong one of the family, while her husband, Squire Hoblyn, was cut out to be more of an academic. On the surface, they were a model, well-to-do Victorian county family. They were well respected for their warmth and generosity, but time, alcohol, and affairs of the heart were about to change all that forever. Rosalind was spirited and hot-blooded, and while her brother was drinking himself to death, she was falling in love with the family's coachman, John Jones. To the shame of the surrounding local gentry, the romance blossomed. They ran away to South Africa, but the affair was doomed. Returning after a few months, Rosalind married another man, Thomas Figg, a tea merchant, and was banished to the New World, never to return. Eventually, the family in Cornwall, one by one, died out, leaving no heirs to the estate, except for a boy born 6,000 miles away, Rosalind's son. The estate has since passed from this son, Francis, to her grandson, John. Both have been absentee landlords, and the estate has been gradually eroded. The original 2,000 acres is down now to less than 1,000. In their absence, the estate has been run by the official solicitor, William McBride, and his local land agent. This, the oldest farm here, has just been sold to pay for repairs and administration costs.
They've installed a new garden gate, and I think they've
McBride has tried in vain to track down Figg Hoblyn, but his whereabouts remain a mystery. All he has to go on is a mailing address in California.
Although he won't acknowledge me, I'm working for him. And everything I do, I've got to try and remember that all the time. It's not my estate, much as I should like it to be. But the real thing is that I'm working for John Paget in case he decides to come back. I write to him from time to time. I tell him what's happening. And I offer him the money that's accumulating, because we accumulate the income. But until he's prepared to say, I accept your accounts, please send me the money, I can't, under the restrictions of that the court puts on me, just sort of send a cheque off into the blue. Anyway, I don't believe he'd accept it.
A spider specialist, John Figg Hoblyn, once taught entomology and botany at San Jose University. But he left there nearly 30 years ago, and the trail has now gone cold. His life is a web of intrigue. Now, we know he's somewhere here in Santa Barbara because of the anonymous mailing address. There's not a lot to go on, but I asked Derek Fuchs, the retired Cornish police superintendent, to set off on a manhunt.
I've always been a bit of a local historian. I like poking my nose into things, you see. And as far as the, particularly if it's interesting, and I thought the Figg Hoblyn story was more than interesting. It was downright ridiculous to me because you've got a fella there who's appears to be heir to a fortune and he's just not getting on and doing anything about it. And that was something I couldn't understand. Normally anybody would sign on the dotted line and get things sorted out, but it had been going on for something like 20 years. I think the last of the English Hoblyns died out in 1951. And it had been open to him to get in among it straight away afterwards, and he just hadn't done it. And there we were in 73 when I first came in contact with him, and he still hadn't proved his title and just couldn't understand why. That's what I'd like to find out. Sorry. It's a challenge. A lot of people want to know the answer to the Hoblyn mystery, and none of them that I can think of will ever get the chance, and to think that I'm going to get that opportunity was rather incredible. It's over 20 years since I saw John Paget Figg Hoblyn, but I've still got a vivid recollection of him standing there in my office with his notebook in his hand and his pen poised, waiting for me to speak. It's the only time anybody had ever drawn a notebook on me. And although it's a fair time since I saw him, I still reckon that if I see him, I shall recognise him again. and I certainly hope we do. He'd got just a bit of a cast in one eye. He's quite an intelligent fellow, but very belligerent, very suspicious. Took a lot of getting through to, and he was an odd sort of character because I really was going out of my way to try to help him, but I don't think I ever really got across to him. Very suspicious. Didn't trust anybody. My only knowledge of America has been from the TV. Perhaps I shouldn't take quite so much notice of it in future, but this is a really marvellous place, and we're really able to get inside this town and look at it and start weighing up where John Paget's likely to be living and where he isn't likely to be living. So I think if there's a possibility of finding where John Paget, Figg Hoblyn's hiding out, I think we're going to be able to do that. This is 133 East Delagare Street. This is a place where we wrote to John Paget, Figg Hoblyn. He obviously picks up his letters there, but how often people come in, it's obviously a pretty slack period now, but he must have picked up his letters from there. But how long you have to wait and what time he comes or what time anybody comes is anybody's guess. It's just a question of having to stake out the place. It's like Fort Knox over there. It looks like it inside. It's locked and there's a security patrol that visits it. So obviously they've got the security regulations tightened up, and I don't see anything that we can do other than sit out and wait and see if he comes.
So Derek waited and waited, but Mr. Figg Hoblyn didn't come. You can waste a lot of time hanging around a mail drop. I mistakenly thought it should only take a week to find the elusive squire, and a week is all we could afford. Even the weather seemed to be against us, but like all detective stories, we had a lucky break. While Derek was looking at his photographs over breakfast, Joyce, our waitress, thought she remembered the name Figg Hoblyn from somewhere deep in the past.
Who could forget that name?
I don't believe it. How come you've heard of him?
I think he was a member of the Trinity Church. Why is he so hard to find? Isn't he in the phone book?
No, he's not. He's not in anything, actually. But we still think he's around here somewhere, but he's not listed anywhere.
Well, what are you looking for him for?
Well, he's inherited an estate back in England, in Cornwall. It's something nice. I mean, if you were to...
When you say it's nice, what do you mean it's nice?
Well, there's a lot of land and buildings and property that, you know, it's worth a lot of money. So if it was you, I think you would go for it.
Well, I might, of course. If it were I might go for it, except for who knows, you know. I mean, has it got tenant farmers in it?
There are tenant farmers, yes.
Well, I heard Cornishmen are about as hard to get along with as anybody in the world. I mean, maybe he doesn't want a pickle at his age.
How do you mean? What's your experience with Cornishmen?
No, I just read about, you know.
I see.
More stubborn than Scots, but if he doesn't want to be found, I would hate to be the person to tell you how to find him.
Joyce may not have a high regard for Cornishmen, but she was fascinated enough to make some inquiries of her own, and she discovered in the pages of a 1949 Stanford University yearbook that she'd been to college with him. At least it proved that he'd existed and was then living in Carpinteria, close to Santa Barbara. It was easier to get information about John Paget's father, Francis Figg Hoblyn. He'd owned a small plot of land near Carpinteria, and he grew oranges and lemons and had a shack here and lived here for a while. That seemed a good place for Derek to start inquiries.
So this is the plot of land where Francis Figg Hoblyn lived, plot 6500, Loma del Rincon. And this was taken over by the Santa Barbara County Highway people for a new route, and they paid $70,000 for this and sent checks for third amounts to each of the children, and they returned them. Fortunately, we've been asking around here, and there's a couple of Japanese farmers that live just down the road, and they were here when Francis was farming, and so we're just off down the road now to see if we can see them.
Mr. Ota, my name's Derek Folkes, I'm from England.
I think you know that we're looking for a Mr. Francis Figg Hoblyn that used to farm round here. Do you remember him?
Yes. He was great on gold mining.
Was he?
And then he...
What, round here?
Huh?
Round here?
No, he's probably, I don't know, wherever the gold mining was. And then he got into trouble by selling shares in his gold mine. And the authorities were after him, so, you know, because he's selling false gold mining stocks.
In 1947, John Paget's gold mining father, Francis, came to Cornwall to visit his old aunts and to look over the estate. The visit was well documented by the papers of the day, with his words preserved for eternity. But what was his real reason for coming over?
Well, there's two reasons that I'm here, really. The first reason was to look over the estate, see what has to be done and make some plans. The second reason is that, well, I'm a miner. And I own a gold mine in California. It's a good mine, too. And, well, I thought that I should offer family and friends here in England a chance to take a share. Watch your step. Be about 10 minutes. Now, this is my daughter, Ann. She's got a sister, younger sister, Peggy. And the two of them got this funny little dog called Bobby Dingo. It's a critter that runs around. My son, John, he's going to Stanford at the minute. And after that, he's going to agricultural college. And it's my hope that the two of us will come back here and put this place right, back like it should be. I wanted to tell you this story about my mother. Now, she died just after the earthquake in Santa Barbara in the hospital. Now, she was only in the hospital for a headache or something like that. But there we were, and she was holding my hand, and she said, "Son, the one thing that I want is to be brought back and buried beside my mother and my father. And that's what I aim to do."
This has just got to be the most brilliant cemetery in the world. I've never seen anything like it for view and also for the care that's taken there. And furthermore, for the fantastic range of people. There's Colman there, the film star. If you go through the... I like looking round churchyards for the history it gives. And this place is really something special. I would say if you're going to be buried anywhere in the world, this is the place to be. Well, I think this must be the simplest of the stones in the Santa Barbara churchyard, which is pretty sad, actually. And she's got a husband alongside, and there isn't even a stone for him, because this is the squire's daughter that ran away from home in 1883. She brought embarrassment on the family, and because of that was sort of sent away from England and never returned. Francis, her son, actually, did say that he would take her remains back to Colan in England and bury them alongside her father, because although she brought shame on the family, father still stayed true to her and loved her and supported her as best he could. But it's rather sad that she should be left out here in Santa Barbara and he, the one who loved her, is still back in England. I'll visit his tombstone when I get back home, and at least we'll have the memory. And it's very nice and very satisfying, of all we've heard about the Hoblyn family, to find at least we know where their resting place is. And I find that quite pleasing, very satisfying.
Derek had made all the usual inquiries, but the mail drop held a certain fascination for all of us. We felt drawn to it like a magnet. Mr. Figg Hoblyn stayed away. The most practical thing to do was to get help from the local police, but they really didn't want to know. It's as if a missing person in America holds no mystery. The advice they gave was painfully obvious.
You've never heard of this guy, have you? He's got a rather unusual name, Figg Hoblyn.
No, I have never heard of the name.
And have you got any ideas where we could perhaps start looking? Because he's not on voters.
Well, you know,
he's not on telephone.
You know, we checked in the phone directory, and yes. There's nothing in there. But you might want to go to the Santa Barbara County Courthouse Hall of Records.
Yes.
Once there, you can look for that name on parcels of property where deeds are registered.
We understand that they use the driving license as a check guarantee card, which we don't do in England. Is that an open record that we could get at?
Yes, you can go to the Department of Motor Vehicles.
Yes.
And for a $3 fee, you can check that name against a valid California driver's license.
Brilliant. That would be worth
$3. Save you a lot of time, too.
Yeah, it certainly would.
So, with high hopes, Derek tried the driving license office. If he drives, he's got to be here.
So much for the sheriff of Santa Barbara. Him and his $3 for information. He got it all wrong. They got the same sort of privacy laws as we've got in England. Couldn't even charm anything out of the young lady. That's another dead end, and it's raining as well.
Back in Cornwall, it's raining too. But we have more luck in tracing another branch of the Figg Hoblyn family. He's also an American and the missing squire's first cousin, and next in line to inherit should anything happen to John Paget. John Westrop Figg Hoblyn and his wife Jerry want nothing more than to run the estate. And every time they come back to it, they see changes.
Wonder what Mount Joy is gonna look like. Oh my gosh, huh?
Oh dear.
They're remodeling, but they've sold it, I'll bet. Look at the yard. That thing's totally tore up.
My goodness.
Well, that's one gone.
That's been sold.
Yep.
The estate didn't do that.
Oh, that's sad. Sad, sad, sad. There's not going to be anything left of this thing. There's not going to be nothing left of this estate.
Yeah. Huh. Somebody's bought it, huh?
Yep. Gosh. I think man could cry just looking at what they're doing to this.
John and Jerry Westrop Figg Hoblyn have made regular visits here from their farm in America. They live in hope that in the absence of John Paget, their reclusive cousin, the authorities would allow them to take over and care for the estate. It's a dream that most of the local people here in the parish of Colan would share with them.
You, as the whoever owns the estate, you at the moment you're losing a lot of money.
Very much so.
By other people's legal charges and such like. Which seems a pity that somebody doesn't claim it.
Well, you asking that, this is a kind of a really can be a sore side, because we asked to take the place of the official, not the official solicitor, but his land agents and everything.
To be appointed conservators.
Be part of it.
Yeah.
And instead of them giving all that money away, let part of the family run it. I mean, no, it belongs to the cousin.
Yes.
But until he takes it, it should be kept together.
Yes, that's right.
And let Figg Hoblyn be on the place running it. And they wouldn't do this. No, they said we weren't qualified and they couldn't do it, but yet they can give it to outsiders and let them spend the money however they want, but they can't let one of the family do it.
Yeah.
Well, this is very sad.
John and Jerry look over what's left of Fir Hill Manor, once the center, the heart of a prosperous rural community. Now all that's left are a few souvenirs amongst the rubble to take back to America.
This piece of the slate.
Oh, I want some more slate. Yes, I have to have some more slate to take home.
The slate off of the roof.
I have to take that.
Okay. Here's the old fireplace and everything.
Yeah. Oh, God, it's gonna come down. Look, it was all... Oh, dear, it was such a pretty house. The ivy's the only thing holding it up. There's another fireplace in here, too, in this other room here.
Don't fall down.
Oh, gosh, it must have been such a pretty house.
This is the family. This is where the family started, and we ended up in the United States. But yes, there's the ties here. It's
the roots.
You feel it right here that this is where it all started, and it's really a shame to see it go the way it's going. It really is. There's absolutely no excuse for it. There's none. And I think what's left of it should be turned over to somebody that wants to keep it up and at least try to make something out of it. And at the present time, that's myself. That's,
at least the only one that cares.
Yeah, that's it, the only one that cares.
Back in Santa Barbara, Derek tries the courthouse.
With all the freedom of information these people have over here, I thought that it would have been relatively simple to find someone. We've been through most of the records. We've been through the library, old telephones, old city registers and the like. We've been in driving licenses. We've just got one place to go.
What's the last name?
We're sorry. We have reached an answering machine. To place another call, press 1 now. Or to end this call, hang up.
Thank you.
Did you know them very well? Fairly well, yes. I couldn't call around and see you, could I?
No.
Would you mind if I did?
Yeah.
You wouldn't want me to?
No.
Well, thanks very much for talking to me, Mrs. Ozina. I hope you didn't mind, but we had hoped to see you. But if you don't wish us to call, we have to respect your wishes. So thanks very much indeed. Goodbye.
The problem that there is over here, of course, is that people are very secretive about who they are and where they live. If they're in the telephone directory, they don't give an address. If you ring them up, they're usually on a recorder, so you can't get at them. They don't speak to you until they call you back. It's quite frustrating. We've just got one place left on the official list, and that's the tax office. And let's hope that he's paying tax or that they've had some record of him over the years.
No, that's employees only. Yeah, it says here. We're not allowed in there.
Oh.
That's
a 204.
No, that's 203.
Yep.
That's 202. It'll be this one here. You're in.
Now, what's about to happen is a real bizarre coincidence. While Derek makes his inquiries, a voice from behind interrupts.
Is this the Figg Hoblyn fellow?
John Paget.
Mr. Figg Hoblyn. Yeah, John Paget. Was that his son or?
No, Francis.
Well, go ahead and we'll talk about this later. I just happen to know all about this, so.
You're kidding me.
No. Very peculiar situation, so let's sit down and talk about it after you. I know it won't show up anymore.
It turned out that Francis C. had been trying to track down John Paget Figg Hoblyn and his sister Margaret for months now.
Can I just ask, what sort of job do you do that you're interested in these sort of things?
I'm a forensic genealogist.
What's that?
That means...
I've not come across one of those before.
We intervene in estates where it's apparent that there are some missing heirs.
And do you do this thing all the time?
Yeah, that's what I do for a living.
Well, you heard the name of the fellow that we're looking for, John Paget Figg Hoblyn. How do you think you can help us to find him?
I took it upon myself to locate them about 8 months ago when they refused to accept some of the distribution, about $30,000, from their father's estate.
Refused?
Yes, there were some problems with the estate, and I believe that they were not happy with the way it was administered here locally.
How did you try and get in touch with them then?
Last summer, I finally found an address for them, and it was through the latest address in their father's estate, and I wrote to them at that address, and they refused the envelope.
What sort of address was it?
It turned out to be a mail drop over on De La Guerra Street.
In fact, it was the same anonymous mail drop that Derek had been waiting outside for the best part of a week. The only thing that Francis could suggest was to check every telephone directory for the entire state of California. So in a local bookshop, Francis used his magic computer disk with listings from all over the country to try and find the missing squire. Hopes were raised briefly with the discovery of a distant cousin living somewhere near San Francisco.
The same family, I suspect they're nephews.
Every lead had come to nothing, and then a chance meeting with a woman in a beachside bar changed everything. She said she could find John Paget and his sister. A day later, she phoned to arrange a meeting. She didn't want to be recognized, and she was reluctant to give Derek the address she'd found.
He's living in a trailer park in the area, in two cars, one of which apparently they keep their possessions in. The other one is like a Jeep with a back built onto it, like a camper, flowers planted on the top, and I gather that's where they sleep. It's amazing.
Well, this is the Carpinteria camper park that our contact has given us the address of for John Paget, Figg Hoblyn and his sister. And would you believe it, this California place over here, look at that rainbow right in front of us. I just don't believe it. I've never seen one like it in my life. We're definitely not going to get the cameraman past that one. But anyway, here we are. This is the trailer park where we understand that John and his sister are living.
It was uncanny. It was like finding a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. We made a few inquiries and found the Figg Hoblyns were away, and so we decided to go in and see for ourselves where they lived.
Right. So this one on the left here now?
No, it's behind here. You go next behind one. Here. No, it's just there. It's the second caravan in.
So if you turn in here.
I'll turn left here.
Yeah. And then you'll have to back out.
And that's it there, the green Jeep with the flowers. And the Ford Galaxy is their home.
Christ, that's unbelievable. That's incredible. Just one old car that they can only sit in.
But with all the flowers,
and the back of a truck.
You can see they still love the countryside, I guess.
It's brilliant. It's a nice little touch, but it's very pathetic that to think they're going to come back here and that's all they've got to live in.
He could, if he wished, live in an old farmhouse amongst the rolling fields of Cornwall, but has chosen instead life in the back of a truck. Derek's plan was to wait outside the trailer park in the hope that the Figg Hoblyns might appear.
We've cruised past this particular trailer park a couple of times, and I think they all think we're FBI or something like that. You can see all the Mexicans going over their past histories, and I think there must be a few illegal immigrants in there because they're all like, if you've seen an excited Mexican park, you can see one down there. So we've just come back a little bit and we've changed cars. We've got an older car because ours really did stand out initially. We got a brand new Chevy and it didn't really fit into the scene down there. So we're on an older car now and we're sitting back, and hopefully the Mexicans will cool down so that the next time we go in there, they won't get too excited.
While Derek kept watch outside, I recorded on a mini camera a man I thought was John Paget. A day later, Derek was sure he spotted him and his sister get on a bus destined for Santa Barbara. We hoped to find them at the mail drop.
Okay, Derek, we're following this bus because, well, your hunch is that this bus is taking the Figg Hoblyn to the mail drop in the center of Santa Barbara. And if your hunch is right, then we'll confront them and ask them there. It's public property and they're a bit funny about things like that over here. Right, we have to pull and keep. I've seen the car already, so we'll
just pull in here.
The bus turned out to be a false lead, but an hour or so later, Derek saw them quite by chance in the street.
John and Margaret, could we talk to you, John, please? I think you've had a letter from our friends in the BBC. We'd just like to help you if you could, and we'd like you to help us to see if you'd come to Cornwall and take over your estate, because we really can't understand, and no one else can, why you're not coming over. We really would like to help you, John.
We're just trying to help, Mr. Figg Hoblyn.
We don't want to cause you any distress.
We have a letter.
Yes, but you
everything
said
everything has to be in writing.
I've got that here for you, Margaret.
Everything is in writing.
I've got the thing in writing here. We got you, but you said you were considering it. Could I let you see what we have?
Wait for something in writing.
Can I let you see what we have? We've put it in writing. We've got a history of the family both in America and in Newquay. Can we give it to you? Would you like to take it? Instead of the mailbox, would you like me to give it to you? Sir?
I'm not after Harrison.
No. He's looking very harassed.
That was a really horrible experience in a way. I wish we'd never tracked them down. But that's what we came over here for. And having seen where they're living and the conditions under which they're living, it can only be that they must be in need of some financial assistance. And if we could have helped them in any way with this program by claiming their title or whatever, that's what I hoped we could have done. And it's very sad. One thing I'm sure that we'll never see John Paget Figg Hoblyn as the Squire of Colan. I'm sure we'll never see him over there. It's very sad. I feel pretty awful about it, really. I would like to have helped, and I don't think that we can. I think he wouldn't even accept it. Certainly he wouldn't talk to us, and Margaret isn't helpful either, but I suppose she's protecting him in a way. And I think we're gonna have to leave it there, but I really would have liked to have helped him. By the old family grave in Cornwall, the Westropp Figg Hoblyns make a final plea to the official solicitor to take over the running of the estate.
Now, on the other side is, you know that John Paget will never show up in Cornwall. I think you'd have an earthquake
before.
I've heard.
And I'm here, and I'm going to be here, and I just want to know what is going to happen.
Well, as far
from your
as, I,
side.
As far as I'm concerned, you know, the courts have said that John Paget Figg Hoblyn is the life tenant of the estate under the 1879 settlement.
Boy.
And as far as I know, I've got to manage the estate as if he was going to come back tomorrow. It's my job.
Well, yes. We're not arguing that. We're just questioning that.
I know what you're saying.
He's hopeless.
All I've got to say is that according to the settlement, according to the court, after John Padgett, it's you. Unless he does something in the meantime.
Well, you know, that's and not going to happen.
And there's been no sign of him doing anything in the meantime, but he could do it any day, and I've got to work on the assumption that he will.
John Padgett could have taken over that estate since 1965, and he's failed to do it. His behaviour's completely illogical. We also hope that if he didn't want to take over the responsibility, that he'd let someone else, his cousin, for example. Everyone would be delighted if he'd do that, but he won't even speak to him, let alone let him take over the responsibility.
A few months after finding John Padgett Figg Hoblyn, news of Derek's find appeared in the British press.
I must say that I was more than a little surprised to think that we'd gone out to California to look for this guy and then found that as soon as we got back, somebody leaked what we'd done to the press, and it came out in local press first and then in the nationals. They say they went and did an interview with him, and I very much doubt that. I think that was a bit of journalistic license. He's not the sort of guy to talk to anyone. He wouldn't talk to me, and I'm sure that he wouldn't talk to any other reporter. His sister might have spoken to them, but if she'd have said anything, it would have been to tell them to go away. That's about all that she would have said. I suppose one thing's come out of it, whether it will do any good or not, I don't know, and that is that one of the distant Hoblyns, I'm not quite sure how he fits into the picture, but he saw the press reports, and he's come forward now with some idea that may possibly take the story on for another chapter, or at least there'll be a postscript to it if he does what he says he'll do.
Richard Hoblyn, a stockbroker and a distant relative, has been following the story for most of his life and wants the matter resolved.
Although we represent only a small part of the Hoblyn family, we have watched this saga unfold since Victorian times, and particularly over the last four decades or so. Despite the efforts of the official solicitor, the estate has shrunk in size, and a great deal of work is going to be required still over the next 20 years or so to try and rebuild the estate. And ideally, the estate should be rebuilt by a member or members of the Hoblyn family. One of the ideas put forward was to put all the members of the family under one roof and actually try and thrash out a way of perhaps rebuilding the estate. But until the situation is clarified between John Figg Hoblyn and the official solicitor, it is doubtless that this won't happen.
I don't honestly think they've got a cat in hell chance of ever getting through to John Padgett Figg Hoblyn. It's all right going over there and trying to talk to him, but I don't believe he'll speak, and I certainly don't believe that he'll ever give up his title to the Hoblyn estate. I just wish them the best of luck.
John Padgett's cousins prepare to go back to America. They came over with such high hopes that things might change, but instead they return with a few souvenirs from the rubble of Thurhill Manor.
I can't believe anybody is acting and doing what he's doing or the way he's doing it. It's just hard. Maybe using the word eccentric or whatever, I don't know. I just can't believe it. Maybe my mental outlook or whatever has to be totally different than his, but I cannot believe what he's doing. I cannot believe that he will not come over and take this estate. I cannot believe that he's living the way he's living. I just can't believe it. He's not living up to the Figg Hoblyn, the Hoblyn standards. That's all there is to it. He's just not living up to it.
We would like to think there were a way somewhere in the law that something could be done, but our solicitor hasn't found it. If there's a way, we'd like to save it before it's gone. Before our grandchild is an old man and finds ruins or farms that are all sold and gone. I wish there were a way within the law.
Thank you very much. Yes. Yeah. And I hope to see you when we come back.
The Westropp Figg Hoblyns have been to Cornwall many times and have spent a great deal of money pursuing their claim to the Hoblyn estate. but there seemed an air of finality about their departure. Will they ever return?
No, most definitely not. I do not think so. I think that my hopes that I could come back, but I'm going to say no, but the way things are going and the time spans in my life or whatever, no. It might be my children, but not me. No.
You really feel that at the bottom of your heart?
I do. I would love to come back, but I don't think it's going to do. I think it's going to keep on being handled by the official solicitor and slowly be all sold off. I really do.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that.
So am I. It's really sad to say.
On your word.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Don't go yet. Wait for the count. One, two, three, four. Slow, slow. Quick, quick, slow, slow. Nice rise. Running the body up. Now you turn again. Nice rise. Keep that hand holding nicely. Right, three quarter turns.
We did what we went out there for. We found John Paget, Figg Hoblyn, and his sister Margaret. And the sad part is that we now know that there's no chance of him ever coming over here and accepting his responsibility and looking after the Hoblyn estate. I did 40 years in the police service and I've seen all types. The way they behave is just completely illogical and very sad. I'm glad I've been there, I'm glad I've seen him, but I haven't resolved the problem as to what's going to happen to the estate.
Next Tuesday's Picture This at 8 o'clock reveals a revolutionary technique that's enabled a young boy to speak clearly for the first time. And there's an extra Picture This on Monday night, looking at the people who do the worst jobs in the world. It's at 10 o'clock on BBC Two.